Hello and welcome.
Hello,
it's not a pod. It's not one of my podcasts. Today. It's something going wrong, so it's okay. At least, as long as the internet stays on, we're golden. Anyway, for those that are listening and not watching the episode, welcome to the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this edition. I've absolutely ruined my introduction already, so I apologize. But I am joined by a guest that by popular demand, that is on the show now. Former champion in BOP wrestling, which we'll get into in the show. And I only got the results like 10 minutes ago, so thank God. It's awkward. It's Fraser Girvan. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Lovely to be on.
I'm excited to have you on, just because, like I say, a lot of people, like I said, off camera as well, just when I was putting names out there, a couple came back and always Fraser Girvan was suggested. So I'm not about to put pressure on you, but I'm hoping it's good. So I'm hoping that at least you've got some decent stories to tell.
Otherwise, we'll have got plenty of stories.
Excellent. Otherwise, right. It's going to be like an hour or so of us just of me trying to like drag stories out of you, because I've done that before and they're not fun episodes to do. Anyway, so we'll start with kind of the basic question, as we do with all episodes. I'm just going to try and... Someone did ask it on Instagram, so I'll at least give them the credit. Cat Stewart, 92, asked, what made you start pro wrestling? And who was your idol? But we'll bash them all in at one.
That's a kind of long-winded one. But okay. I can talk about how I got into wrestling, which is a really funny story.
Okay, we'll do the idol one a little later on then.
It kind of trails into that a wee bit. SmackDown vs. Raw 2008. As many people, it was the video games that got me into it. Didn't watch wrestling at all growing up, and it was because my mum used to work in Blockbuster, renting that game, and just fell in love with it from then. And then it was my brother who then started wrestling school. I started to go to Scottish shows, and it was specifically seeing BT Gunn winning the NWA Scottish heavyweight belt. That was what made me go, one day I'm going to do that. So, in a way, BT Gunn. Him and Lionheart.
Of course, and now you're modelling your look. But I mean, so am I, it seems, on both with the bald head beard. It's a good look. It's a classic look, it seems to be, in Scottish wrestling now, and just wrestling in general.
Male pattern baldness. Gets us all one day.
It does. I mean, the weirdest thing, I think I've said in a previous episode, I have a full head of hair. It's just super blonde at the top. So
yeah,
I look bald, and it is awkward when people call me bald and I go, no, touch it, there's hair, there's no bald spot. Anyway, I've had one sip of Monster and I'm super excited, so let's just carry on. So SmackDown vs. Raw 2008, that was the featuring ECW one, wasn't it?
Yeah,
Undertaker, cool. Bobby Lashley, Cena, I think, on the front.
Yes, it was actually.
Who was your guy?
It was CM Punk. Obviously, he had tattoos and he looked cool. Him and Jeff Hardy being, you know, alternative and into the stuff I was into. Because it was actually, I remember the thing that caught my eye was on the back of it. I saw someone swinging a guitar. I think it was like CM Punk or something like that, swinging a guitar. And in my head, being 8 years old, not knowing any better, going, I like music. That was all it took. That was all it took.
I love that. I love that. That's literally, you look at it and go, I can hit people with guitars. Oh, it must be a music game. Let's go for it.
Yeah, Guitar Hero.
So CM Punk then, Jeff Hardy, big fan of Jeff Hardy here. I think after 200 odd episodes, people probably will know that now. It was just cool. Was that your kind of, were you straight edge? Were you kind of that scene where you
tried to kid myself on for years that I was straight edge. And then I turned 50. And like most people from Glasgow area, you just kind of go from there.
15, you started late.
I know. I was a good boy. I was an altar server and whatnot, so I had to keep up appearances. But now look at me. That's the baldness. That's where it came from. Years of abuse.
And I barely drink. I don't understand how I've got a full head of hair. We've already established that. It's fine. Right. So from that point onwards then, so you said 2008, and then first brother got into wrestling himself. But were you aware of the local scene before he did that, or was it just a case of he started, so he went, oh, you know?
It was zero clue of the local scene. It was my brother, obviously being older, he's like 5 years older, so he was more aware of like actual going ons in the world. And it was, I can't remember specifically, but I think it was either the paper, something like that came up, something to do with a Scottish wrestling show advert. And he went, didn't even imagine that could be a thing. You know what I mean? We didn't, because we had no clue about World of Sport. We had no clue about anything going on. We didn't even go to the tribute shows until like later on. So he looked up Scottish wrestling, and it just so happened that it was the old Area 52 unit in Linwood, which became the Source School. He went, well, I'm going to go there, obviously. And it was literally, he found out about it 1 week, and I think he went the next week. And then that was him. Just from that point onwards. And then through that is where we started going to shows.
And then you became his practice dummy, I'm assuming.
Yeah. Still am.
So from, you said you weren't aware of it until you really got into the video games and then watching it. So watching it was, again, CM Punk, Jeff Hardy, the guys that you were drawn to, or when you actually watched the shows, was there guys that, what we're talking, 2008, 2009, so as a dark time in wrestling. So trying to remember who was actually there. Cena, probably.
Well, see, this is the thing. I had this really nice combination of, I was into wrestling, but I was poor, so I couldn't watch WWE. All I got was the WWE experience on a Sunday morning before I went to church. No, sorry, after I went to church.
Yes, it was after, yeah.
So it was always just the highlights from the week. And I remember, the odd occasion Sky would stick out an episode of Raw, and it was like Christmas Day came early. Every time that happened, me and Lewis would huddle around the TV, buzzing. But most of our wrestling, or watching of wrestling, came through very bad quality indie wrestling on YouTube and TNA.
Oh,
Blockbuster.
Of course. You said your mum worked at Blockbuster. Yeah, we're going to speak about TNA, because why not? Oh, God, that's so many memories from myself growing up when I was... I'm a bit older. So it would be the case of coming home and seeing metal on Sunday after church. But so WWE experience, was it Scott Stanford or John the Coachman at the time? I can't remember who.
No, it was... Was it Scott Stanford? I think it was Scott Stanford to start. Yeah, I'd be lying, honestly. I can't even remember who the host was.
Sorry, you weren't there for that, though. You were there to actually see like Mark Henry like throw someone. So,
yeah.
What time? Jeez, that's... I remember when I moved back to my folks once, and that was it. That was my only WWE, unless it's YouTube, that I could go on to, and it was waiting. So 1 hour of Raw. So, let's watch 1 hour of Raw.
Yeah.
And, those are the days. Nowadays, kids have got it too easy.
Too easy. Getting too the easy. Highlights on YouTube. I remember when it was like a rare occurrence to find like new WWE footage on YouTube, because we'd get copyright strike straight away. And before they discovered how to use their YouTube channel properly.
Although, if you wanted anything WWE, go onto their own website and watch John Cena's Five Questions with the Champ, or Crime Time. They did their Word of the Week and Dirt Sheet.
Oh, the Dirt Sheet, yeah.
Dirt Sheet. Oh, so that was the best. Like I say, the kids these days, they can just go to YouTube, go to their streaming devices, and access anything. But we had to make some effort. Back in our day.
Back in my day.
So, low quality indie wrestling, what we're talking about here, is it CZW or just whatever you can find?
CZW, Shikara, the rare time you could find about Ring of Honor, that was like God's gift. Lewis was obviously training at this point, so he was like trying to be the wee mark that he was, watching like New Japan or Noah. I tried to kid on that I would watch it, but I had no clue what was going on because I was 8 years old.
It's just a bunch of barrel chested folks slapping each other. That's what I saw.
It was a lot of guys like Chuck Taylor and Colt Cabana. Because again, I was a child. I had the attention span of a 10-year-old. So it was guys like that I was obsessed with. And it eventually, as I started to get more wise to it, it was guys like Chris Hero and like Cesaro or Claudio, who I was a really big fan of, and Danielson especially. But no, that was like how that's where I have like a real fond like nostalgia for, is watching all of that. And whenever I could just get that wee nugget of like a full match, even. So that was another problem. It was like, it was never full matches. It would be like somebody would make like a highlight reel, they'd make a music video or something like that. And that was what I would get. So I still, to this day, love like edits and highlight reels and stuff like that, because it just, it reminds me of like when it, what made me love wrestling to begin with.
The funny thing about those things was, I mean, you came in just at the time when the Wrestling Channel had stopped. It became some sort of fight shite, which just, but there was always the case where someone would upload part one, part two, part three, but part two would get the copyright strike, so you'd only get one and three. So you never got the middle bit of the match.
Yeah. I do actually remember, I hated that. What a nightmare to be a wrestling fan who was poor back then.
I know. You go to eBay. I mean, I've still have a VHS player in my loft, and that's went to eBay, £5 VHS. That's it. Get me Royal Rumble 95. I didn't need a WWE network at that time. But TNA then. I'm good to speak TNA. So you came in just before the Hogan era. So that's a very interesting time to come into it. When they were actually profitable between 2007 and 2010. TNA was just amazing, wasn't it? I'm sure that period. Yes.
Like, see now, especially having gotten into wrestling, see watching that era specifically, in particular the X Division, it's as if these guys didn't realise they had to pay for healthcare over there. See the way that they take like bumps and the way they throw themselves about, especially like see all the gimmick matches they've done, like the cages and the is it Elevation X? No, Elevation X is the cage one where the Rhino and AJ Styles done.
The scaffold thing that was.
Yeah. Amazing. All the daft gimmick matches done. See the way they used to chuck themselves about. It's insane that any of them can walk.
I think it's ridiculous. I mean, it's amazing that there was never any big story. Well, I mean, the only one, even then, wasn't really about that, but it was like Chris Candido, of course. He got a blood clot and he went on a flight, and then you know, all that happened. But even then, like, there was no major scary injuries in TNA. And like you're saying, we watch the X Division stuff back, and the bit they always show for X Division stuff with AJ Styles doing the last minute fall off the Ultimate X thing, and Daniels flinging himself onto the middle of the X as well. You look at it and go, how did they do that? You know, it was the best. It was the best times. And then Hogan came in, and especially when they were doing all that in their six-sided ring, which everyone hated.
Oh, exactly. That's what I mean. That adds to my point. It's the fact they were doing all this in a ring that sucked, you know. But I'll make this point. I enjoyed the Hogan era. Like, I really love the Hogan era. It was bad, but like in that like so bad that it's good way, you know.
It's like one of those. What's going to happen next is there's Orlando Jordan pouring milk on himself. Okay, let's move on to the next bit. Here's Val Venus.
That's the best. Val Venus, get him back. Give him the belt. Pat that Josh Alexander boy back in X Division.
Oh, we look at the NWA with James Mitchell and getting him thrown off. I mean, I'm sure Val Venus will be fine with his selling his hemp oil and his weed supplements. I mean, he'll be fine.
You know. we'll get to that.
Gone off the rails. I love this podcast already. Right, okay. So from that point onwards, then you got a little bit into the scene. You getting DVDs, VHSs, whatever, snippets on YouTube, and whatever Lewis could borrow from folk to watch, and you'd have to try and tolerate Japanese wrestling. Was there any point in that, like that stage, where there was any aspirations, thinking, oh, that's fine, he's going to train, and then I'm going to start afterwards, and we're going to be tag team champions? Was there any aspirations at that point, or did that come a little bit later on?
So, this is a weird one. It was like, when I was about 11, I remember around about then, my dad used to help out a lot at shows. Just, he was there for the sake of Lewis, but he works within like the trades. So it was like anything daft he needed for shows, space heaters, lights, guardrails, stuff like that, he would always help out. And because of that is like a kind of favourite time, they're like, we understand Fraser's about anyway, so if you want, we can train him. It was more so I would just show up at training and like Damo would show me like wee bits and pieces, but it would just be me and him. But I was a fat 11-year-old, so I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. Because like, I'd always wanted it, but I knew, having seen what Lewis had been through, I was like, it's a bit much for me. Even when I was 11, I knew it was too much for me. So I went through like the training process a few times, and there was always roadblocks. Like, I started at 11, but I felt like I was too young. Then I started again at 16, and I was in a roller coaster accident.
What? Right, okay, right. Carry on with that. We'll get into that.
Yeah. I knew that was going to come up eventually. And I started at 19 again, and then I gave up because the compensation money I'd gotten from that roller coaster crash ran out, so I had to get a job. And I didn't have as much free time. And it wasn't until last year, about March, it was like I'd finally, because in the back of my mind, even from when I started, it's like when I got my first job at 16, I was always in my mindset like, I'm doing this job so I can make money, so then I can have the free time to go to wrestling training. But things just always got in the way, I felt. And it was, I just remember I came to the realization going, I've got all this free time, got all this extra money. Why don't I just do it? And I just kind of never looked back.
Okay, right. A lot to unpack in there.
There's an elephant in the room.
We're going to go straight back to the roller coaster because, you know, I think this is going to be, ironically, a roller coaster of a story, right?
Yes.
Roller coaster accident. Set the scene.
So, in 2016, June 26th, maybe, I don't know, at 6 o'clock, I don't know the specifics, I was on, I don't know if you remember it, it was called the Tsunami Roller Coaster at M&D's.
No.
Maybe.
But, okay.
No. That crashed. I was on it. Yeah, pretty scary. Nobody died, thankfully, and annoyingly, not annoyingly, shouldn't say that, like a month prior was the Alton Towers accident, so we got kind of overshadowed in the news. Anytime I tell someone this story, they go, oh, were you in Alton Towers? I was like, nah, I was in the wee jobber one the next month.
27th of June was when the article went up in The Guardian.
So when's the 26th? I was right.
There we go. Three children. I don't want to save cookies. Thank you. Okay. Three children have been seriously hurt in a theme park roller coaster crash in which a total of 10 people were hospitalized. I had no idea I was going to be able to, this was going to be happening today. Sammy Ryan derailed and hit the ground at M&D's amusement park at Strathclyde Country Park, Motherwell, near Glasgow. Hopefully, I'm not giving you PTSD. I just realized that. I'm just reading it and reliving it to you.
I'm losing my mind right now.
Witnesses said people were trapped upside down when the ride came off the rails at 3:40 p.m. Eight children and two adults were taken to hospital nearby. Holy.
Yeah. Yeah. I was on, I was 16, and I remember it was so funny because when it first happened, obviously, so the news report said from 35 feet at like 40 miles per hour or something like that is how we crashed. And I remember because I'd been on this roller coaster a bunch of times before. I remember the like sudden realization of this doesn't feel the same as last time. And before I knew it, I was on the floor, hanging like upside down. And it was like I had all this pain on my right hand side, but I couldn't feel it on my left hand side. And my first thought was I'd had a stroke. I thought the roller coaster accident was so bad that I'd had a stroke and I could only feel the pain on one side. I hadn't, thankfully. I just got very unfortunate and my entire right-hand side took a beating. For clarification, I broke my arm and I tore my quad. And that was before I even got into wrestling. Classic wrestling injury.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, that's pretty mental.
I mean, now when you look back at it, it's one of those things where, like, say you thought you had a stroke and all that, but like in my head, thinking, oh, the right side hurts, but I can't feel the left. The left side's the one I'm going to worry about because I can't feel that one.
Well, that was the thing. But this was the other thing. It happens. I get unhooked eventually because, of course, mayhem, as you can imagine, at a roller coaster accident. They unhook me, get me down, and I tried to stand up because adrenaline's going through my system. So I'm like, I'll be fine. And I remember just collapsing in a heap going, oh no, this is good. This is pretty bad. this isn't just a wee bump and a scrape. It's funny though, because I had adrenaline going through me and I got put in an ambulance pretty quickly and I got taken to the hospital and almost instantly they got me on morphine.
Oh yeah.
Now at this time, I was with my ex-girlfriend who her mum phoned my mum and dad saying, don't worry, Fraser's been in an accident, but don't worry, he's not dead. And they were like, well, we need to go to the hospital right away. And obviously it's, M&D's is like near Wishaw General Hospital, so that's where we went. And I'm from just outside of Glasgow. So my mum and dad barrel it down the motorway. They get there and I come out and I'm all like laughing and joking. My mum's in hysterics. She can't believe it. And at the same time, my brother is on holiday. So he's completely unaware that any of this is going on. But he sees the Facebook post that's went up saying there's been an accident at M&D's that my ex-girlfriend had put up. And he goes, oh, she probably dropped Lewis up Fraser a message, make sure he's okay. And I message him going, just a few bumps and scrapes. He goes, oh, must be fine. So he leaves it. It wasn't until he started seeing all the news posts going up and my mum and dad text him and stuff. And it's like, oh, Fraser, you actually right? And I was like, yeah, no, I told him the injuries. He was like, why do you think it was only bumps and scrapes? I was like, oh, I was full of morphine. I don't know. I thought I was fine.
That's an absolute mental story. Yeah. I'm not going to lie. That's incredible. I love that your parents actually came because when I broke my arm, stupidly, I phoned my mum, or someone phoned my mum to say that, oh, Billy had been in an accident. It wasn't an accident. I fell off a child's spinning disc and I was 21 and I was drunk. And she was like, oh, we need to go see him. And my dad turned around and went, is he still alive? Yeah. I'll give him morphine. We'll go see him in the morning. What are we doing? It's midnight. What are we going to do now? I was off my tits on morphine. It was amazing. It was a great thing.
Morphine is a hell of a drug.
I can see why people get addicted to it. It's one of those where you just, it's like, oh, there's a little bit of a niggle. Press the button. And the pain goes away. Well,
yeah.
This has probably been one of the best tangents we've had on the podcast ever. So from that point, like you're saying, the compo money arrived. Possibly we're in the newspaper doing the face, you know, the sad face next to the roller coaster pointing at it.
Thankfully not. I never quite made the papers myself. My shoe did, but I had reports and that on my door. But my lawyer at the time for my compensation claim was like, don't talk to the papers. Mm-hmm. It's going to ruin any chance of you getting anything. I was like, okay. Whatever you say, Pop.
Have you kept the cutting of your shoe though? Is that just...
See if you look at the articles. It would be a pain trying to like figure this out. I'll try and send it to you afterwards because like it's like a snippet of me. But I was technically on it. I was on this morning. I was on with Philip Schofield, which
geez.
I know. It was cool at the time.
We stayed off camera before we started. We shouldn't mention anyone dodgy. And here we are, Philip Schofield. assuming you weren't in his presence. Right. Right. I'm fascinated. I'm going to look into that so much in the next. And when I put it initially, I put a tsunami roller coaster crash. One came up from 2019, so they haven't learned clearly.
Yes,
it still happens. Right. So from that point, did you have like you said the you tried training again around about that time? Was that just more of a case of life's too short kind of thing, and you have the availability and the funding to do it? Was that the kind of attitude you had?
Are you talking about before? Because it was, I trained like for like a couple of weeks and then that happened and then I stopped.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough. Yeah, that makes sense. You stopped. I suppose after when like, what, 19, you said you tried again. That's kind of where we're
I had the compensation money, so I had this expendable income. It took me a while to get it, admittedly, but when I had it, I spent it. I don't care. I got £24,000 for it, and I spent it in 4 months.
That is, I mean, have you got anything left to show for it?
A dog and a watch. That's it.
I was kind of hoping you'd like turn the camera a bit, and there's like a full size stormtrooper outfit that you had in the corner, or something, just something wildly ridiculous to buy. I really don't know how we're gonna top that, but we'll try. So
yeah, let's talk about wrestling now.
Why not? Everyone can pester you on social media about the other things that you spent $24,000 on. $27,000, whatever it was, $24,000. I'm still just baffled by that whole thing. Right. Let's try and reset a little bit and talk about wrestling. So you went back to training eventually, and this is the one that stuck. The time it stuck. And then a pandemic happened. So, you know.
Yeah. It was actually the pandemic was a big part of why I got back into it. Because it was on the arse end of that, it was like the kind of come to God moment. I went, I've wasted a lot of time. Mm-hmm. And the pandemic took away so much time that I went, if I don't do it now, I'll probably never do it. So it was a real never, never kind of moment. And I'm glad, because it's went quite well. This is the time I finally started.
I mean, you've done not bad in the 6-ish months you've been on shows, something like that. So we'll definitely get into that. So it was just after the pandemic, then you properly went, right, that's it. I need to do this now or never. I've already had my near death experience. I've had my I suppose kind of lottery win. I've done that. I've done all the big things in life. Now I need to actually do the thing I want to do, which is wrestling. You went for it. Must be weird then. So when you started, it must have been just kind of like I said, the arse end of the pandemic. So would it be a little like one to ones again? Maybe it was not as it wasn't as much close contact, was it? Or
I got back into training just as like everything opened up, like as we were back to normal. So this was like 2022. I came back. Was it? Yes, it was. It was about March 2022 is when I got back to training. And by that point, things had really calmed down, like across the board. Mm-hmm. Thankfully. So I was back and it was just like, it was full classes. It wasn't like the one-to-ones and stuff, but I've been told how that went. And that sounds dreadful, truth be told. That's just, I can't imagine learning much in those type of situations.
Are you more of like a doer when it comes to learning? So like things like online classes wouldn't have.
This is just me with like in life, school and stuff like that. I was seeing as soon as it wasn't like in person doing the thing, I never clicked, you know. That's why like I'm glad I didn't go to uni during like the pandemic or something like that, because that would have killed me.
I know, it was mad. I mean, I was at the tail end of a college course, like a 3-month college course, and last month of it was online learning, and nobody knew how to work Zoom. I mean, I've been doing this for 3 years, and I still don't know how to work it. But nobody knew how to work it, and I only had one paper to put in, thankfully, and it didn't take me long to do, and I passed. And it's not a very exciting qualification. It's called childcare. Child health care and practice. I don't know. It was a free course and it was called CHAMP, and that was really the only thing that sold me on it. Was I could call myself qualified CHAMP.
Hell yeah!
Yeah.
I'll
so,
that.
There we go, Billy Strachan CHAMP. So it was weird. I'm the same. If you tell me that I'm going to look at a computer screen to learn, I'm just gonna sit and just go, I've got my phone. I'm just gonna do something else for however long. And
product this generation, it's just no attention span. I'm a much better like a face to face conversation. Like I remember during the pandemic, like I'd lost my job just before COVID as well, and I was doing trying to do interviews over Zoom. See, try to like be a professional over a computer, lost on me. I'm not even old, but I've got like the technical skills of a 60-year-old. So you try to set up this Zoom meeting, I was like panicking the entire time going, this isn't going to work, this isn't going to work. Because I'm so used to it. Tech just does not agree with me. But yeah.
That's the weirdest thing. Like, I'm just now just telling you stories because I think I need to try and claw back something from you almost dying a roller coaster. But I did an interview during the Zoom era, and you know, there's something unjustified about sitting there in a shirt and tie and joggers.
Yeah,
you're just sitting there, I'm
more generous by putting on the joggers. I was sitting there just raw dogging it in my boxers.
I was just like, you're just staring at them, still thinking, you know that I'm in my joggers. You know this. Why am I doing this facade of the shirt and tie? You know I'm in my joggers.
I think that was the big thing for me. It was like it felt really, really unauthentic. You know, it felt fake, almost.
Yeah.
It never clicked to me. So every time I've done one, like I've done like 3 interviews over the pandemic, and every single one, I walked out of it going, that's up. Not getting that job.
By the third one, had you decided to put on trousers, or was it still just?
Nah. Oh. Maybe that was the problem. They could sense it. Probably the full length mirror behind me.
Standing up at the end to pretend to shake their hands probably was the downfall.
Oh.
Just the crotch in the camera. All right. Wrestling, I suppose. Why not? I feel like the wrestling portion's just gonna be a letdown in comparison to the actual tangent going off. We'll get there. Right, okay. So started March 2022. I wrote down you had your debut at the last Source show. Didn't write down the date for it because that was way too professional. So I'm going to look for that. So when you started Source, back at Source, when March 2022 came around, did you realize that, oh, you'd actually taken in quite a lot? I'm not saying the classes were easy, but was it a lot of your memory getting jogged each session?
It was. I'd always picked up tidbits from Lewis. And I've said this to a lot of people, you don't realise how hard wrestling is until you actually do it. Like, every aspect of it, I was like, oh, I know nothing. Because I'd been involved since I was like 8. And like, by the time I got into it, I was like 22. I thought, I'll be fine. Nope. Mm-hmm. It's one thing to think, you know, but then once you actually get involved and you're there, totally different. Like, and that took a lot for me to like just sit back and let my ego not get in the way and just go, I don't know as much as I think I do. But if I just ignore that side of my brain and I just listen, I'll be fine. And that's what I've done. I tried to, at least, for the most part.
The weirdest thing is, like you said, you started, you got quote unquote trained when you were a lot younger, and it was Demo, and of course then he went to do WWE, and now he's back. By the time you were starting again, he was back on the independents, just about. If he wasn't, he was near as damn it. A lot, when you look at that, in that, what, 10 years, that's a big change in the landscape, not only in Scottish wrestling, British wrestling, but in the US as well. And it's almost a case of, even though you weren't really, aiming to be a wrestler at 11. A lot has passed by in that time, so this just shows how it evolved so quickly.
Well, I was can't remember who I was speaking about this the other day, but it's weird. Like, so obviously, I've been watching this scene since, and like the British scene in general, since I was about 8 years old. So I would be about 2008. And it's weird because I feel like we've went like full circle, almost. Where it was like, back then, it was the only thing was family-friendly entertainment, really. And I feel like we've went through the phase of like the American influence and the Japanese influence and stuff like that, of like the indie like work rate style wrestling. I feel like we're back to like the stage of, you know, family-friendly wrestling is where it's at. You know, that's the main audience. It's strange, like you say, how things have evolved. I think a big part of it as well was just with COVID, a lot of people got turned away from wrestling because there was no wrestling. So when it came back, the ones who were still watching it were kids and families. So I think that's why those shows are still doing so well, because I feel like there's just not as much of an audience for that style of wrestling anymore. That, like, real, just before the pandemic, what was, like, big isn't as big anymore.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose ICW would be a perfect example. It was the big thing, and it was more of an adult audience because they did the blood and what have you and the death matches. And then, like you said, when the world came back, it was more, I think, as well, the cost of living crisis, and everyone needed value for their money. And I think family shows was possibly a better way to do that because you pay, what, 40 quid for a family ticket, and you get to meet the wrestlers, and you get to do the yeeing and the booing and all that. And it's an absolute 3 hours of absolute fun entertainment, whereas going to a death match show, it's an adult audience, so it's not as inclusive to a family as well. So it's just, yeah, it's just changing in what works. And I love family wrestling is my kind of jam. I'm not into death matches, as people may have watched when I did the interview with Andrew from Bleeding Gums, which
yeah,
I can't watch back because I know that I was an absolute bitch during that. I just know every time you mentioned something, I was like, oh no.
Stop.
don't tell me about the nettles again. That was just but you know what, they've sold well and people like it, so I don't know. What do I know? It's, if people like it, they'll pay for it, and that's the most important thing. So yeah, your family friendly just seems to be the way to go, and you see from the crowds. I mean, you were at BOP last night as of recording, and they do, I don't know how, but they do huge crowds, but their market isn't social media.
Great shows, that's why.
Obviously,
that's why they do well.
You're not on the poster, though. But no, they must do heavy family marketing as well, because you don't, their social media is next to zero, but they pull in a big crowd. So it's clear that families is the way forward for now. There's still going to be niches like Bleeding Gums and I still try to throw it in every so often. So there is obviously a niche market for that thing. And then you see like the more Japanese style or the more pure style of wrestling coming through, things like Disco does it sometimes. So there is a market for everything, a variety show, so to speak. I've got off my soapbox now. I feel like I've started going into a rant tangent of for nobody but myself. Anyway, let's go to some questions then. And we'll,
good idea.
I'll talk about you being a former champion already. That sounded pretty dickish, was it? Former champion already, Gene. Okay, let's see. See, CFin1967 on Instagram has asked, do you think you and your dad could swap places and anyone would notice?
I'm glad that's the first question he asked.
That's the only one, I think.
The answer is no. No one would notice. Me and my dad are the spitting image of each other. Like, it's scary. If you were to ever, I'm not going to show you my dad right now, but see, it's me, Lewis, and my dad. It's this wee section of our face here, identical. There's a picture of us from my dad's birthday, like a few years ago, where we're standing like side by side by side. We're making the exact same face. And it's as if someone's edited it, so it's the same face three times.
The face swap app or something like that. Amazing. You think I would actually get to wrestling questions, but I'm just going in the order that I've got them here. Jamie Fitzpatrick has asked, does he polish his head? So there's that.
No, I don't polish it. I moisturize it when I shave it. I got enough baldy comments last night at BOP. I'm still feeling a bit tender about that.
I'll see if, hang on, I'll make sure there's no other ones.
No, I think, is that a lot of older questions?
No, I think there's just the one. So I think we're okay. Okay, right, that's fine. There is one. Oh god, that's that one. Colton Davis has asked quite a few, and we'll just round off the bald comments with this one. How proud are you of how well Hook is doing in AEW?
I'm very proud of my son, yes. Was that Colton who asked that?
Colton asked that one. He sent through quite a lot, I'll be honest. But
for context, we were over at the OTT seminar the other weekend, and it was at one point we were doing stuff in the ring. I get in the ring and Trent goes, "Great tan." I was like, "All right, I've got him hooked." Pardon the pun. And then he made a comment about me looking like Taz. I went, "Well, I guess I need to do a suplex now." And honestly, the squeal of joy that came out of him when I done it. So the joke is that because I've got a very good tan, I'm on the shorter side. And I'm a bit stocky. But is that I look like Tan? Tan? Taz?
I mean, that could be your tribute name. Tan?
Fraz. That's my name.
Well, speaking of that, we've got Gabe underscore MC123 with "What's happening, Fraz? For Alcatraz, long time no hear."
Hello, Gabriel. It's a friend from school.
Let's move on then. We did get wrestling questions, if you would believe it, but we're still going to go through the shite ones first before we get there.
Yes, please.
Colt Davis has also asked, "What height are you?"
When I stand on my wallet, I'm 10 foot tall. And that's all I'm going to say about that.
Lewis Girvan has asked,
"Here we go.
Why did he choose to get into wrestling rather than the family fish business?"
So, it's a difficult one to talk about because Lewis had the same problem. My dad is an acclaimed fisherman. See the name Kings of Catch? That's where that came from originally. It was my dad had a business called the King of Catch. And that's where the tag team name, the Kings of Catch, came from. It fit because of the Catch as Catch Can wrestling, but it originally came through my dad. And it's a violent market. It's not an easy business to break into. My dad just didn't want that lifestyle for us. There's too much partying, drugs, booze, that stuff in it. So yeah, that's just why. Never got into the fishing business. Too dangerous. Wrestling's easier.
You didn't want to be baited into it. Right. There we go. I'm a podcaster, by the way. Right. Okay, right. Ian Skinner asking, "What do you want?"
Just in general.
That's it. What do you want? That was the question.
I want a proper question, Ian. That's what I want.
Oh, I mean, has he asked you the question about the bacon?
Yeah, no, I've bloody well heard it enough times.
I hate that.
Don't want to hear it again.
I hate that question because it short circuits my brain and I can't.
I watched him do it with Joe Hendry once and legitimately, it looked like Joe's brains were melting out his ears as he listened to him go on and on.
I've heard Ian's got a reputation for that, but we've always had a good time with Ian on the podcast.
Good luck.
Especially having to edit stuff out and
can imagine.
It makes me work hard for hilarious interviews. Right, let's see what else we can get out before we go into the wrestling stuff. Sean Martin has asked why. That's it. Why?
I think that was meant to be funny, but I don't see the joke.
Okay, cool. We'll move on. Kind of wrestling related. Judas Gray just says, "Fight me."
Gladly. He's a guy that I'd love to work. Legitimately, all jokes aside, I love his stuff. Very good friends with him. But it's just finding a place to do it.
So we're segueing back into wrestling. We're going to segue back to wrestling now because he also asked, "Have you used any of the stuff you practiced or we practiced?"
Yes. The amount of times I've germined that boy, the amount of times that we've traded swantons, yes, I've used quite a bit of it.
Well, I mean, that's because you're the human suplex machine. You need to do the germs.
That's on.
All works. Okay, right. Let's see. We're now doing wrestling.
There we go.
Grant McIver, well, okay, it's the last one, then we'll actually get to wrestling. Grant McIver asking, why does he look like he's the older brother?
Male pattern baldness, we've discussed this, Billy.
I know. Lewis does have a wonderful set of head of hair. It's very distracting at times.
I don't know where it comes from. I'm bald, my dad's bald, my uncle's bald. Like, every man in my family is bald, except for that lanky streak of piss.
If you didn't have the exact same face, you'd be asking questions. You'd be watching the milkman.
Yeah, I would be. luscious locks.
Like Gaston just going, milk. Right, Jason McCormick has asked, who's the better Girvan brother?
Me.
There we go. I know. Some of these questions, some of the people ask these questions, like, what answer do you expect from turning around and go, well, I think it's...
Actually, I think it's my brother. I think he's really good. No, I'm the best. I am the best.
he's quite good at the wrestling. Right, back into more wrestling stuff. James Blair also asks, he only asked one question. When you want him battered?
Never, because it's not going to happen. Plain and simple.
There we go. Right.
Like to see him try.
Luke.smudge4. What are the chances of you winning at Sacrifice?
Likely. It's my friend who's his interest in wrestling is through like the stuff that I've showed him, because mm-hmm. he's not a wrestling fan, but he loves the Steiner Math promo. Like, he thinks it's one of the funniest things he's ever seen in his life, so he quotes all the time to me.
You know what the best thing is? That was two takes, because the first time Steiner did it, Pete Williams laughed at the end, so he had to do it again. And
I didn't know that. I've heard useless knowledge like that. I had no clue that was a second take.
I'm sure that was a second. I could be totally wrong. I'm misremembering, but I'm sure it was a second take. But yeah, because Pete Williams laughed the first time, so Steiner had to do it again. And I don't know what the first take was, if it was the exact same, but I like to think that the second time was even more intense, because if Pete Williams laughed, he'd be dead.
It would make it even funnier. No, if it was the exact same promo. Like, that was exactly how he meant to deliver it.
Mm-hmm.
Say it. Like, that was memorized. Because that is rambling of the highest degree.
But the best thing is, the math works out. The math's right.
That's true, actually.
That's the funniest bit.
If we're going off of his logic, it does make sense.
Which, Scott Steiner's a terrifying man. If he's not only he survived, but his lung being punctured, and
he survived on like a weekly basis. He done this. He used to do this spot, and it's one of the funniest things of all time. He would catch the crossbody, and then he would try and like do like a moonsault world strongest slam. But of course, back then everyone was like minimum 250. So he's trying to do this, and he's beating himself every time on the top of his head, and he didn't stop doing it. He just kept doing it week after week after week. It's one of the funniest things ever.
It probably makes up for the fact that he's going to drop them on their head later when doing the what was it called again? It wasn't the Frankenstein
screwdriver.
That was it, Steiner screwdriver. Which is a terrifying move to watch. And
that's when wrestling was the best. See, when everyone took steroids and nobody cared about their necks. Before we knew what CTE was, it? Wonderful times.
CTE was probably something you'd get from a hooker. That was
exactly.
Oh, this episode's not getting monetized, is it? Right.
Sorry, bud.
that's fine. That's okay. Patreon, if you want that. Anyway. Okay. Okay, we do have, right. Right, we'll get to the rest of your wrestling career, and then we'll go into that. So, made your debut, your last Source Wrestling graduate. So that's your like last of the Heart Dungeon, which I think Tyson Kidd is. So you're the last of the Source graduates. Made your debut against your own brother, Lewis. What was it like to finally being able to get in front of an audience and being able to do the wrestling?
It was great. Like, it's funny. I was speaking about this to Colton the other day. it's so funny to me the amount of people that act so jaded about wrestling, but how much they, you know, can't be arsed with it. Because I know I'm very early on, but wrestling's just the best. See, like, getting to just go out for a paying audience and do what you love. That's just golden. And getting to do it for the first time against my brother as well, you know, like, I know I was put in a fortunate position because of who I'm related to, but you couldn't have asked for a better debut. You know what I mean? Against my brother, getting to just go out and have fun in front of, like, all my family and my friends and that. It was, like, it was so funny when I had friends afterwards text me going, I get it now. I get why you love wrestling so much, because we could see it on your face the entire time, like, how much you were enjoying yourself. And it's true. Like, I don't know. It's just, it was a really, really fulfilling experience. Yeah.
The live wrestling experience is like no other, though. Like, people, yeah. I mean, I've been a fan for 25 years or something like that now, and people do go, like, oh, why do you go? Isn't the same thing every time? And then when you go and you see the stories, you see the wrestlers enjoying themselves as well, and then you can't help but enjoy it. And people that go to it for the first time go, okay, I get why you go. Like, I get why you go to the wrestling, because it is fun. It is a fun night to go see it. I mean, if the wrestlers clearly aren't enjoying themselves, then it becomes a bit of a chore to watch. But generally, if you can see they're into it, you get into it yourself, and it's the best, like, it's best form of entertainment, in my opinion. Like I say, I've been watching for 25 years, so I'm maybe a bit biased
of being fans of wrestling. But yeah, no, like, that's the point I'm making. It's like, to me, that was the great thing as well. It was like these people who have, like, heard me speak about wrestling my entire life. For them, who have always kind of, like, rolled their eyes or just been like, yeah, whatever, Fraser. For them to finally go, no, I get it. That was, like, a right, we, like, tick, you know? I'm like, finally, I managed to convince all these people that I'm not crazy. You know what I mean?
And, I mean, if one or two come back next time, then, you know, that's a fan converted because of Fraser Girvan, which, you know, it's just not a bad thing to man people, like I said. But yeah, that's and then from that point onwards, like I said, it was the last source show because they got taken over by GPWA.
Not taken over, we merged.
Merged.
It was a mutual agreement.
I mean, David Devlin made it sound like it was takeover, but like in like a mutual takeover. So like I said, not like they came in and went, right, we're taking this. It was
user coming.
Piss off, right? Okay. So you became JPWA. So you went from course, you started knowing about that strange school since it was Area 52, and then you had a little bits with Demo, and then became training with David and Robbie Wishart and Dunbar, probably round about there. And now you're into the GPWA system, which is probably, is there a difference? Is it a little bit more intense? What's the difference at all?
It's more so, it's different perspectives on wrestling, I would say. It's training with new people. And it's like, so obviously the other weekend I was saying I trained at OTT and getting to train with the likes of Joe Cabre and Trent Seven and stuff. And just, it was very similar in that sense. It's getting totally different worldviews on wrestling. It's getting people who view wrestling in a different light. Because getting trained off of one person, you're never going to learn how to be like a good all-round wrestler. You need different perspectives, because no one person is right about all of wrestling. At least that's my opinion on it. I might not be right either, you know, but right. It's just, it was getting to go to a new school, working with different people, with different trainers, with different coaches, sorry. It was getting their perspective on wrestling really opened my eyes. Just obviously Jack Jester, doing it for years now. Getting to pick his brain is like God's gift, you know. It's great because he's been everywhere, you know. So I would say it was different in the sense of different facility, different people, but it was different in a good way, you know.
Yeah.
really helped me. I feel like that's, since training there, I really kind of hit my stride when it comes to like learning, being a good student.
I mean, I suppose for some of your trainers would have been more of a let the wrestling do the talking. I suppose when you go to like GPWA, some of it's a bit more character based because they have that experience with the fight clubs and working with WWE as well for the network. And so they've got a lot of, like I said, different perspective on things because they may be looking for you to be more experienced to work for TV and stuff like that. And it's all, like I said, all a whole different thing. I mean, I could be wrong. I'm the one that's sitting in the northeast of Scotland, never trained a day in my life, so I'm just guessing this is how it works. But yeah, so it just sounds so interesting because, of course, when the footage or I've seen pictures of that from the 5 pound wrestling stuff that gets done for friends and families and what have you, it was just interesting to see guys from Source suddenly in this new environment and the asylum and all that kind of stuff. It was just weird in the respect of. You didn't expect Source to go, but then now it's in the glitz and glamour kind of thing of the GPWA setup. It was a very interesting time for wrestling.
Yeah.
From that point forward, you made your GPWA debut as well. And from that point, you went Blockbuster and Bop as well.
Yeah.
Terrible name. Sorry, Bop. Sorry, guys. But it's SWA was amazing. This is the opinion of me, myself only, and not for anyone else. But Bop itself, though, like when you see the results from the shows, it's wild. It's just a wild show itself. But you got to team with your brother in that show against Risky Business.
Yes.
And I think he's now.
And Mr. 10 Names, Gambit LeBeau, I think that's what he's calling himself right now. Who was AJ Diaz, but after some writing room changes, it became Gambit LeBeau. I'm bad with names.
Is that why you kind of stuck with Fraser Girvan? You weren't like going, I'm not going for a big gimmick name. I'm not going to go as the Gerv or anything. Fraz. Yeah. Maybe the future. Maybe that's the...
Maybe one day. Maybe you will see the debut of Fraz one day and I'll come out with my wee singlet and my wee shirt boots on. But for now, I'm Fraser Girvan.
That's it. No knee pads. Super tan. But what was it like? So from that point then, you already wrestled Lewis, but then you got to actually team with them. Again, was that something
team that you wanted to do? Great. Because Lewis is obviously such an established act when it comes to like tag team wrestling in Britain. You know, he has got like the way that he views tag wrestling, the way that he, it's just the way his mind works. It's like, it's hard to explain, but it's great to see work. See him thinking, like working out ways to do things. It makes my job way easier because he knows what he's doing. You know, I just fill in the gap. You know, plus as well, it's like, it's just cool, you know, getting to tag my brother.
Like, I mean, you get to copy the like the great tag team brothers in the past, like the Hardy Boys and who find Jeff. My head's just went Dudley Boys, which I know that's not strictly right.
Hey, it's a big family. You're talking about
the Edge and Christian. The Guns. There we go. The Guns. There's an
error. There we go.
Bucks. I can't believe I had to get through the Edge and Christian and the Dudleys before I got to the Young Bucks.
I was thinking more home soil with like the coffees or KOE.
Oh yeah, coffee. Oh yeah. Keep it Scottish based.
You're the Scottish Wrestling Network, remember, Billy?
That would have made way more sense if I started. But yeah, so you know Lewis, of course, yeah, he's got a lot of experience, former tag team champion in a couple of places as well. So does he kind of set you homework for tag team stuff, or does he leave you to kind of pick his brain and pick other people's brains and find your own kind of?
He's very good at letting me figure things out on my own because he doesn't want to be a case of me just referring to him all the time. Mm-hmm. However, we spend a lot of time in each other's company, and we watch a lot of wrestling together. That's basically anytime we're in each other's company, that's what we'll do. We'll watch wrestling. We'll just talk about it. Because it's, in a lot of ways, it's like all we really can talk about, you know? Mm-hmm. Like the one constant in both of our lives for so long, and it's the thing that we love, you know? Not to sound too obsessed, but so anything we are together, it's watching wrestling, it's breaking down wrestling, it's discussing why things work, why things don't work, you know, what will work for us, what we could do in the future and stuff.
Does it make wrestling more exciting for you that you do now watch it as in an analytical sense, as opposed to just as a fan?
Oh, I enjoy wrestling way more now that I am a wrestler. Like, see, when I was just a fan, it was so easy for me to sit back and go, oh, that wasn't the best, or oh, I didn't like that. See, now I just love wrestling, every aspect of it. Even if it's not the best, I still can appreciate it for what it is. Come back to me in like a year, I'll probably be a bit more jaded, but right now, you know, pretty happy with wrestling. Things are going pretty well.
So we'll go back to Blockbuster. We'll talk about your match. It'll be coming up. When this goes out, it'll be tomorrow. It'll happen. And then we'll go back to the questions, because they are actually wrestling related, the rest of them, I think. Unless one or two slip through that's asking you about your head again. Right. So Blockbuster's coming up on the 25th of November. You'll be facing KOE, Adam King and Marcus King. This was kind of set up back in August, when Lewis was teaming with Adam King while Marcus was injured. Yes, that's the timeline of events. And you came out to make the save. And now we've got brother tag team versus brother tag team coming up, which I don't think has happened that often in Scotland, at the very least.
I don't know. Definitely. I'm pretty sure that's never happened before. KOE would have never wrestled with the Coffees, I don't think. I don't think that those ever crossed over. And if I'm right, I'm really trying to make sure that I don't mess this up here, but I think that's it. I think those are the only two like brother tag teams that have ever came through Scotland.
I mean, there's Grant and Glenn Dunbar, of course. There was
Sorry, that's a good point. Famous brother tag team.
But no, but you are right. I think I can't think of it off the top of my head, but I assume that I know that Grant McIver's brother wrestled for a little bit as well. But I don't think
I don't think they ever tagged.
No, so
I know of.
But someone will correct me.
Definitely.
Dork will correct me.
Some dork called Grant McIver. Actually, that's what you get for saying I look like the older brother.
That's it. If first comment is Grant going, well, actually, me and Jack faced KOE in a training match, and you know,
actually,
so from that point on, it's historic. It's a historic moment that you're facing the KOE.
First time ever,
possibly first time ever. We're going to say it is. Are you looking for, is that something that you look forward to? Of course, I mean, you love wrestling. I take that as obvious, but. Facing our brother tag team, there's some sort of unwritten kind of chemistry bond between the two teams. So,
KOE, I think, have done a lot of the groundwork for the tag scene in Scotland to bring it back up from the COVID era. I'd wager they're one of the best teams in Britain. And it's a real stepping stone, you know. They're like they're the bar in Scotland for tag wrestlers right now, in my opinion. No one really compares. So to face them this early on is a pretty big deal, you know. I'm really looking forward to to prove, you know, I'm on that level, you know. Lewis is obviously, he'll be fine. It's my time to shine.
No, this is your interview. We don't need to speak about Lewis. He can come on himself, and we can.
He'll talk about himself. Trust me.
A big historic match. If people, I'll do sell. It'll probably be sold out by the time that I'm actually speaking about it. So it'll be very awkward. But if you haven't got a ticket, get a ticket, because it's a historic moment in Scottish wrestling. the Girvan brothers. Are you just going by Girvan brothers? Are you going by the Girvan boys? Have you decided on a tag team name?
Brother, we've been called like three different names. It's either the Girvans, because obviously,
yeah,
just plural, or Brothers Girvan is what we've been called as well.
I quite like Brothers Girvan. That's
similar to, it was a play on Brothers Grimm.
So
that was the name we were going with, but hey, call us whatever you like.
Just don't call us late for supper. God, how old am I? Right, anyway, right. So before that historic match, of course, we were talking, you were at Bottle last night, and, you know, you became Scottish X Division champion. No, they're just Scottish X champion over there at Bop.
And I was cheated.
Well, I mean,
I was
let's not talk about that bit yet. Let's talk about the historic bit first of you becoming a champion. Probably one of the rising champions in Scottish wrestling history. I don't think there's anyone who's made their debut and won a title faster, unless someone's going to prove me wrong again. Grant, probably.
Actually,
that's pretty cool that you became a champion.
If it is the case, and it's been a total oversight in my case, apologies, because the only one I can think of off the top of my head, I'm pretty sure Joe Hendry won the Lord of the Ring title.
Oh, you are right. You are, yeah. Okay,
I don't know how soon that was after his debut. I don't think it was too long. I'm sure we could go back and do the going cage match and figure it out, but
that's exactly what I'm doing. Right, I'm gonna find out, and then we'll either celebrate. Hey,
if it's me and Joe Hendry, that's pretty good company. That guy's doing pretty well for himself.
He's doing okay. He's doing okay. So he won. He made his debut October 2013. I've got here. So that was the Battle Zone for SWA, mm-hmm. Yes. And then he won the Lord of the Ring title April 2014.
So I've gotten beat.
You've gotten beat.
I've gotten beat by a month, I think.
Yeah.
So, it's pretty cool statistic, man.
I would say so. Yeah, you've beaten Joe Hendry at being the I think that'll be it. Surely, I can't think of. Again, Grant, you can correct us. So become a champion. Even if it was only for what you said, 6 minutes or something like that, that's still a pretty cool thing to have in your CV within your first year of wrestling.
It's not lost on me at all.
How was that 6 minutes? Was that the best 6 minutes of your life?
And even I added benefit of it. Years ago, it was when that belt was first invented. It was my brother who was in the final for the tournament for it.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, Wild Boar beat him, because of course he did. But, you know, my brother never ended up winning that belt. So for me to get it was pretty cool. It was a nice full circle moment.
Mm-hmm.
My Girvan finally got it. It was a pretty sweet 5 minutes. And as I say, that dastardly Darren Blair cheated me. Took advantage of the fact that I was tired. I was weak. I'm going to get emotional.
I know, there's the big pregnant pause there. Of course, as per my source, Darren J. Blair cashed in his previously won, opening Battle Royal win entrance to be sourced somewhere. I don't know, I'll find out. He cashed in and became the new Scottish X champion. And I've seen all the posts and the pictures and that of people celebrating him winning the belt. But, you know, when you think about the circumstances around it, it's a
team. Where was my congrats? Where was my lovely post from everyone saying how much I deserved it?
Absolutely shocking. But don't worry. At some point, when I remember to do so, your name will be in the history books on our website somewhere the title history of that title. You'll be there. Internet connection is unstable. Wonderful. We're now actually going to speak probably the rest of the wrestling questions we've got, and internet's going to die. That seems like it's going to be right for us here, as this conversation has been going. Okay, right. Back to wrestling. Back to Instagram, because I think I've asked everything on Facebook or Twitter or X. I don't know. This monster's wearing off now. Okay, so Gaz Williams, he has asked, dream opponents. So you mentioned BT Gunn, assume he's there, but who's your dream opponents?
Triple H, The Undertaker, all the people who are going to make me a lot of money to wrestle. No.
I like the way you think.
there's the obvious ones. There's the ones I'm fans of, the guys like your Moxleys and stuff like that. But I think to tie it back into Scottish Wrestling Network, I'll talk about people in the local scene who I'd really like to work. Obviously, like you said, BT Gunn. He was a guy that, like I say, I loved Jeff Hardy when I was younger. And I saw BT Gunn and went, well, he's like the Scottish Jeff Hardy. So I love him now. Mm-hmm. I was like 8 years old, you know. All I needed was long hair. I was like, that's the same person.
Maybe don't tell BT Gunn that you're a fan of his when you're 8 years old, because I don't think, I mean, I hear he does hard chops. I don't think that he's going to take too kindly to that.
Yeah, no, that probably regret saying this, but hey ho, that's life. I don't know. See, this dream opponent question, it came up a few times. Like we spoke about it. I've spoke with Lewis about this, and it's a weird one.
I think the first kind of answers make the more sense when you say dream opponents. I do have a question that's kind of similar, which probably is a bit more, a better way of wording it. But yeah, dream opponents is the ones you make most money with, or it gives you the most notoriety. That's how I would think it anyway. So when you're saying Triple H, Undertaker, John Cena, that's the one, yeah, that's your dream opponents, because that's the ones that's going to set you up for life, kind of thing. Yeah. Colton Davis has asked goal opponents, which I think is a bit more goal of opponents. A better way to word it. So who are the guys you want to work up to prove yourself to? Like you say, BT Gunn being one of them. Who would be your goal opponents?
Some of the people who, like, it's a lot of people that I grew up watching. Because again, like I say, grew up poor. So the people I watched were like the people in the Scottish scene. Guys like Jack Jester, you know, Wolfgang, the Coffees. I would say my brother.
Don't you love technology?
Has it started working? Okay, there we go.
That's fine. I just kept it all recording, so I will take out the bit where I'm just like staring into the distance, looking like a great pleb.
You want to start back from that goal opponent question?
I mean, what I'll do is I've got a nice little technical difficulties graphic, which I'm just telling everyone because I'll cut this bit out. But I'll stick it in there. It'll be fine. So goal opponents, we're talking about, Jester, and I think I heard Coffee. And then you if you see the screen grab, if it stays as it is, I'm not gonna lie, it's not a very complimentary picture of you.
Probably. No. I've got a very animated face. But as I was saying about goal opponents, it's really just, think of any of the big names that have came through Scotland over the years who are still here. Mm-hmm. Them. That's probably just the easiest way to do it. You know?
I suppose it's 6 months in, it's a bit
open-ended.
Yeah, exactly. If you've been wrestling for, I'm asking it to Lewis, for example, who's getting a lot of mentions in this podcast. He's going to be stroking his luscious long locks and we'll be sitting here jealous. But if we asked him, he's probably got a bit of a shorter list in comparison, because he's wrestled quite a lot of people in his time. So yeah, for yourself, like you're saying, everyone, because you've only had, maybe 10 different opponents at this point. So you've got a lot to work with everywhere.
Yeah.
So speaking of that, but where do you, well, Colton Davis again, he's getting a lot of questions here.
He told me in advance that he was going to do this, so that's fine.
So it's actually two people have asked kind of the same question. We've also got him and Ruben Maypother. Mm-hmm. I apologize if I've got that wrong. He asked, what companies would you want to wrestle with? And Colton Davis asked, promotions you'd like to work with for in the next year? So kind of the same kind of question.
See, that's a good one. Of course, ICW, closest and most prominent in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. That's a big one for me, especially coming up to the GPWA now. Like, that's kind of goal number one right now. That's what I'm really striving for. Out with that, Discovery, just with the history of my brother working there and all the stuff he's done, all the people he's worked there, that's a real big one for me, because I love Discovery, you know.
Yeah.
More of a niche one. Funnily enough, you were speaking about them earlier, Bleeding Gums. I really like deathmatch wrestling, and it's something that really intrigues me. It tickles that part of my brain that probably shouldn't get acknowledged. So yeah, there's another one. Like, that's one, because, like, similar with ICW, it's that adult audience, it's that, it's different, you know?
Yeah.
Stepping out of my comfort zone in a lot of ways. Other than that, you know, anywhere. those are, like, three specifics, but to be honest, I love wrestling. Like, I'd be happy to do it everywhere and anywhere.
Took me, pretty much, is the end goal. It's going, again, it's one of those questions where if you ask someone who's a bit more experienced, it's a bit more of a close-ended question. But for, like you say it yourself, and you, like, you talked about ICW, you're kind of not on the fast track, but you're in the GPWA blockbuster kind of. That's where the kind of, some of their guys go before going to ICW. So if you're ever in a fast track to go, that's the kind of upward to go from. So absolutely possible. Next year we'll see the Girvans, brothers Girvan, Girvan brothers, the Girvan boys,
never seen
Taz and Lewis Studley, where everyone's called your team. Why I went for that team, right? Okay, so entirely possible. Last
Sorry,
question.
In fact, I've got an even better answer. WWE, because they'll pay me a lot of money. That's where I want to work.
AEW to reunite with your son.
Yes, exactly. And take out that body double that they've been putting on the commentary desk.
I know, but I digress. Right, okay. And Colton Davis has also asked, kind of the same, it's probably a bit more realistic question. And where do you see yourself in 5 years, other than in WWE or AEW, making lots of money?
Dead, probably. I have a lot of problems. No. I would like to think I'd be a full-time wrestler in 5 years' time. But, you know, things happen, things change, but that's the goal. You know, as I say, I love wrestling. If I could do this every day, I would. If I could make that my full-time living, 5 years' time, perfect. And I'm going to do everything I can in my power to get to that stage.
Just kind of about, you're saying possibly dead, obviously in a joking sense, but after the roller coaster acts, you know, have you been on a roller coaster since then?
Nope.
I didn't think you would.
No.
I think I knew the answer before I asked, but I was just more curious than anything, because I haven't went on to, I probably shouldn't at my age now, but I haven't went on to children's playground equipment since I broke my arm. That was enough, and yours is a little bit more serious.
Yeah. Person. No, I've no ambition to. Not even for another £24,000. Yeah, no.
That's fair. That's fair enough. That was a question. I was just wriggling a bit in my head there. So yeah, that's all the questions we've got off Instagram. We've got loads, which is great, which truly showed that people are interested, or at least you made an impression enough on people, whether it's your friends or people in the wrestling business, that people are just interested in knowing more about you, which, take that as a compliment, I suppose. Former Scottish ex-champion Fraser Girvan.
Exactly.
Yeah. We ask the same two questions to everyone on this podcast, as you're well aware. As you said, you have listened to the podcast before. So we've asked everyone from Joe Hendry. It didn't quite break it. Actually, I think one of the questions did break his brain slightly. We've asked Scotty Totty, Damo, all of them have been asked the same questions. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Stegosaurus.
Nice. it's just a nice dinosaur.
A nice dinosaur.
And I think I've got my little Stegosaurus here. So that's my...
See, I read something recently. There was a discovery that apparently, so T-Rex are seen as like this insane, like they were like the top dog of like dangerous dinosaurs. I read something the other day. Apparently, it was Stegosaurus, because T-Rex couldn't do anything to them because they had the big spines on the back. What's a T-Rex going to do? Something like that, you know?
And I can't pick it up either.
Yeah, that dogs like me, small with spiky backs, I guess. I don't know.
So yeah, I'll let people learn on this podcast as well. Then our question to ask everyone, which I think was the one that broke Joe Henry for a moment, was what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Nah, the cow, obviously. I've seen cows move, and they move fast. And sheep, like, maybe the numbers game, but not sheep aren't big enough. No, a cow falls over, and the sheep are done for. You know what I mean?
Have you seen the video of the cow running into the sheep head first, and then the sheep, and then the cow just collapses?
No.
I will say, honestly, I think I've probably put a couple million hits on this. Oh, I say million. That's probably pushing it. A couple hundred views, mainly for myself, of this video on YouTube. It is incredible. I'll send you the link to afterwards. But yeah, it's a cow running into a sheep, and the cow collapses afterwards. So
I think that was just a weak cow. I've seen cows, man. Like, things are big. I mean, sheep are not nearly as big. I mean, that's not the... It's a pretty shit sentence. I've seen cows, man. Got that on a t-shirt.
If I actually had episode titles, that's it. That's the one. That's... I've seen cows, man. Anyway.
Thanks a bunch.
Oh god, it's past my bedtime. I'm going delirious now. Right. So mention what your kind of aspirations, hopes are, and what have you, and what you got coming up as well. As we kind of round off our chat here, well, we're both still awake. In the time you've been wrestling, so you've already had historic moments, and you will have as of tomorrow, when you face KOE in the first ever, as far as we're aware, brother versus brother tag team in Scotland. I mean, that's been a mental time. Has there been anything that you didn't think, or I don't know, were surprised to have happened? Whether it's meeting someone that's a fan of yours, or has there been a moment where you've just went, "Oh my god, I'm a wrestler," kind of thing?
Yeah, it was. It was the moment that I walked out the curtain for the first time. It was that real flood of emotions of going, yeah, this is it. I'm doing the thing. You know, I'm doing the thing that I've wanted to do for so long. There's been wee moments since then. Like Bob's great because I'm a baddie. I'm a real baddie because I've got a bald head, and that's apparently enough grounds to not like someone over there. That stinking cesspool that is Paisley.
But spell ball.
But even there, it's like kids who have been like calling for my blood the entire show, still coming up to after me, like all sheepish, going, "Can I get a picture with you?" I go, "That's pretty cool." You know, it's like I'm in no way, shape, or form a celebrity. I'm not even going to pretend that I am. But I've made enough of an impression on like these kids. They go, "Oh, he's pretty cool," you know, and that's the aim of the game, you know, making an impression on the families, the kids, the people who come to these shows. Yeah, that was a cool moment.
So, yeah, for that moment, you are a celebrity to that child, which that sounds amazing. Before we do the social media and all that kind of plug, Summer Rae del Sol's tracksuit. That was a wonderful thing. I've didn't think
beautiful
it was, it was amazing, wasn't it? It's like he's raided Ravy Davies' wardrobe.
That was the first thing I said when I saw him. He looked like one of the gangsters. Have you ever seen The Gentleman, the Guy Ritchie movie?
Yes, I have. Oh yeah, great movie.
I thought he was wearing one of them. I was like, but the thing is, he had the mask on as well. I was like, that guy, he gets it. You know, he gets the game. Shows up in this cool looking tracksuit. So it says there's 150-pound masks. Right next to the tenor Ravisero masks
and the Sin Cara ones, which, you know, is a bit awkward. Throw it in for a fiver, you get the Lucha Dragons.
See?
But no, I was there. I was That was the first thing I saw. As soon as I saw that track, it was like, oh my God, that is a beautiful piece. If people go into the bop wrestling on Facebook and check the photos, it is wonderful.
Gay head is sussed out, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Go to Scotland, what are we going to wear? Tartan tracksuit.
Yes.
Man.
Well, that's definitely why he's done it. He's went tartan. That makes sense.
You know what? He's probably, if he's got England bookings, he's probably went, ah, it's red and white. That'll do.
Yeah.
Double whammy.
He wears like the Spice Girls Union Jack dress. He goes, yeah, this is what they wear over there. It's like, have you ever seen a photo of Mike Tyson when he came over to Scotland? He's wearing like a Scottish rugby top and a kilt. And it's like when you see Snoop Dogg wearing a Celtic top, it just doesn't make sense. It doesn't compute in your head. You know, these two things don't exist in the same world. You know what I mean?
Is it this week Roger Federer or I think came up, Roger Federer was wearing had a picture of him when he was younger, and he showed it during a Q&A with Andy Murray with him wearing a Scotland shirt, and like leaning going, how is this a thing that happened?
Yeah, exactly.
The weirdest thing. And we're gonna go off onto our tangents.
Our tangent,
it's still working. So yeah, I've had a blast with this. I'm so glad people just told me that I had to get you on the podcast, because not only for the roller coaster story, because that's just a madness in itself, but I think we've had a good chat, a little bit of setting the world right in wrestling. Hopefully it doesn't set you back, but I don't think it will. I think we've said good things, and I'm looking forward to seeing where you go in the future as well. It's very exciting time, and hopefully we get to see the brothers Girvan touring and tearing up elsewhere. But where can people find out more about Fraser Girvan?
What I'm doing, where I'm going. Don't follow me on social media. I post a lot of shite. Kidding on. It's at Fraser Girvan everywhere. Twitter, Instagram. I do not have a Facebook page because I don't like Facebook. I'll just be honest. So Twitter and Instagram, that's where you can find me. At Fraser Girvan.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thank you very much for speaking to me today.
No worries. It was all a pleasure.